wrestling fans, welcome to another action-packed, exciting hour of Smoky Mountain Wrestling. Professional wrestling the way it used to be and the way you like it. I'm Bob Caudle, fans, and we've got, as we say, a great hour in store for you this week. On today's program, we'll hear about a disturbing situation involving prime time Brian Lee. We'll see Tim Horner, and we'll also see the Rock and Roll Express in action. And we'll get an update on the efforts of Jim Cornette to secure a return match for his heavenly bodies against the Fantastics in our big main event. The man with the hands of stone, Ronnie Garvin, against Mr. Wonderful, Paul Orndorff, and my tag partner right here, Dutch Mantell.
And then first of all, my special guest today, making his first appearance on Down and Dirty with Dutch, will be the new Smoky Mountain heavyweight champion, the Dirty White Boy, and Ron Wright, and they will be talking about their quest for top competition. And what you see in my hand, we still got Olympic fever going on, so what I'm going to do today, for all the fans at home, I'm going to rate all the matches right here on television.
How are you going to do that, Dutch?
Write it down right here, and I'll show the people what moves, what I score the moves.
All right, fans, there it is from Dutch. We're about ready for the action. Right now, let's go to the ring.
Wrestling fans, introducing first from Castlewood, Virginia, 220 pounds, here is Mike Simpson.
All right, fans, right now making his way to the ring area and a lightning bolt in hand, one of the most popular individuals in all of Smoky Mountain Wrestling, White Lightning, Tim Horner.
Wrestling fans from Morristown, Tennessee, 230 pounds, White Lightning, Tim Horner.
And you know, Dutch, Tim Horner thinks that he ought to be right in there in any list that the Dirty White Boy has.
Well, Charles Manson thinks he ought to be released from prison, too. I don't mean that.
On that list to get a championship chance and a match with the champion. And I think Tim Horner deserves it. He's talking about all of his fans. He's from the mountain areas. He's got a lot of fans around the Smoky Mountain Wrestling area. I think probably one of, if
so
not
you're,
the most.
So you're saying most, since Tim Horner is from the Smoky Mountain area,
that'd be great,
that automatically qualifies him for a title shot? No, I don't
think
be, so.
It would be great to
I
sort of bring the
so,
title
Bob
home,
Bob.
Dutch.
That means I can go to Texas, and just because I'm from Texas, I automatically could step in against the Texas champion.
That was a good takedown right there by Horner very quickly now.
He didn't answer me.
Back on his feet. Hey, we're going to be talking to Brian Lee and Bob Armstrong in our next segment about a very disturbing situation, Dutch, that has come to light this past week. I want to find out more about that.
Okay, now, I told the fans up top I'm going to do some Olympic scoring here, and that's exactly what I'm going to do. I'm going to pick out a move that Tim Horner does first.
Well, Horner went right in, came right back up, had that wrist. As he ducked right under Mike Simpson. Now with that wrist, and again, look, he's got that leverage down, the pressure push. Simpson trying to get the other ones. He's trying to get in a position where at least he can get a test of strength on Horner. Off of the boot, into the corner.
Okay, I'm going.
An arm drag.
Wait a minute, I'm going to rate that move right there. All
right, what's that hip cross?
I'm going to rate that move. I have rated the move. Can you see it?
A 23?
2.3. Of course not.
I didn't
a 23.
See the point.
2.3.
What do you mean a 2.3 on a scale of 10?
You see
that should have been at least a 9.5 or something like that.
No, the technique wasn't there. And the white boy knows the technique's something out there. And he's just not going to give an unqualified opponent a shot at the Smoky Mountain title. He's not going to give Tim Horner a shot.
Well, Simpson hits Horner in the ellipse. He comes off, goes down from that block. Horner rolls right under him, waiting on him. Good standing drop kick. Right on the button. He had a lot of power on that one. He just exploded right under the chin of Sampson, but he missed that elbow. Sampson got high in the air, came with that drop.
Bob,
there's an arm drag takedown again by Horner, and he's got the arm.
Okay, you're saying that you think the Dirty White Boy should grant Tim Horner a title match. Right?
Horner's been looking very sharp lately,
okay,
Dutch, and I think Ron Wright and the White Boy, they just aren't keen on granting him a title match, right?
Okay, but what about the Fantastics not granting the Heavenly Bodies a title shot? What do you have to say about that, Mr. Smarty Pants?
Well, look what they did to the Fantastics.
Big deal!
What they did earlier to jack his leg and to jack his knee, and had a Fantastics
were out for so long, and the back seat that they had to take care of their bodies.
Look, Sampson is all over Tim Horner right now, all over him.
Well, there's Horner down from my elbow as he's
and that supposedly is the number one contender for the Smoky Mountain heavyweight title. I think not.
I didn't say number one, but I said he certainly deserves. He deserves a shot. If anybody does, I think Tim Horner does. But you don't have a kind word to say about any of our. Of our wrestlers that all of the fans seem to like so much, the ones that get in there and wrestle by the rules. And the
Now, you see, if I rated these matches that Tim Horner making now, he'd be below zero.
Below zero?
Below zero.
Turnbuckle. Horner slammed hard to the turnbuckle there by Sampson. Well, trying to come back with a good right hand to the midsection. That was high on the head by Sampson.
Well, he's fighting from the downside right now. This Mike Sampson, a fairly talented wrestler in his own right.
Horner had it blocked.
Wait, I think he's blocked that suplex.
And there's a suplex from Horner.
Or a suplex.
All right, now, what do you rate a move like that?
Well, I'm not going to rate that move right now. It doesn't even deserve rating, actually.
And right
he gave
hand,
him a vertical
right jaw.
Suplex.
There's an elbow.
I call it a suplex, the French pronunciation of it. I'm bilingual, too, Mr. Carter. Tim Horner sort of taking it to Mike Sampson right at this particular part.
Well, he's right on top of him. Horner, like all the great wrestlers and outstanding competitors do, when they get an upper hand, they're going to try to keep it. Now he's in trouble. He got behind Sampson. He's going to roll him up into the package. Is he going to go to the bridge? Yes, sir. You don't get out of that move.
Your winner of the match, White Lightning, Tim Horner.
Tim Horner with the bridge. He's the winner.
Well, let's take a look at it. Tim Horner is trying to climb that mountain. He's trying to get the dirty white boy to take notice of him. A big win right here, I have to admit. A big win for Tim Horner right here, Smoky Mountain Wrestling. He does his signature move, the roll-up with the bridge. It takes him down. Mike Sampson on the receiving end of this defeat. He gets the three count on Mike Sampson. Tim Horner, White Lightning, the winner right here on Smoky Mountain Wrestling.
Fans, you know, Tim Horner suffered a defeat recently, but it wasn't in the ring. White Lightning appeared at a charity dinner in Clarksburg, West Virginia to benefit the Muscular Dystrophy Association. The event was sponsored by WBOY TV 12. And here you're going to see Tim arm wrestle TV 12 general manager Gary Bowden. With an assist from one of the MDA poster boys, Mr. Bowden won. But the real winners are the children helped by this fine organization.
Hey, Tim, that's a great event and a great thing on your part to do that, and I'm sure all of the fans like I appreciate that very much. Let's get back right now, though, to talking about wrestling, and I, too, think you deserve a shot at the champion.
Well, that's right, Bob. You know, that's all I'm asking for. I'm not asking for a whole lot, just a chance at the Smoky Mountain heavyweight title. I can't get a hold of the dirty white boy because I guess he don't have a phone, and it's obviously Ron Wright's doing his booking and matchmaking for him, so he's obviously don't want to give me a chance. But like I said, Bob, all I want is a chance. I want a chance to prove to the people and to myself that I can represent East Tennessee, Eastern Kentucky, North Carolina, South Carolina, wherever Smoky Mountain Wrestling goes. Those people are my people, and I think I can represent them well as Smoky Mountain Heavyweight Champion.
And, Tim, obviously, I think the fans feel the same way about it. Commissioner Bob Armstrong, Commissioner.
I just wanted to show everybody.
What the heck is that?
Right, this is a wanted poster. I found this is on walls on both dressing rooms for the last 2 weeks. The walls have been covered. What it is a wanted poster for Brian Lee. And I just want to read instead of telling everybody. Let me read what it says. $10,000 in cash will be paid to the man who injures Brian Lee to the extent that he is unable to continue to compete in Smoky Mountain Wrestling. This offer is valid until the deed is done. This is trash. We don't need anything like this in Smoky Mountain Wrestling. I want to tell you, Brian, I'm glad you came out here. I'm going to do my best to find out who's at the bottom of this, and I'll do my best to take care of it for you, son.
And I'm going to be right there with you, Bob. I'll tell you what. You know what a man would do for $10,000? I don't know who's at the bottom of this. $10,000 is a lot of money. Not only do I have to worry about getting my title back from White Boy that he stole, I have to worry about men hitting the ring. I have to worry about them hitting me with boards. I have to worry about them bringing a gun to the ring. Obviously, someone in Smoky Mountain Wrestling scared of me. But I'll tell you what, boys, and this goes for everyone in the dressing room. If you want some of prime time, I'm not hard to find. I'm not hiding. I'll stand right in your face. And if you want some of me, you better bring a lunch because it's going to be a long day.
From prime time, Brian Lee, fans.
If you'd like to raise money for your school, club, or civic organization, and you'd like to see the excitement of Smoky Mountain Wrestling live in your hometown, this message is for you. High school and college athletic departments, sports teams, police and fire departments, JCs, civic groups, or any group wishing to raise money can bring the stars of Smoky Mountain Wrestling to town for a night of action and receive a portion of the receipt. Write to us or call Sandy Scott at 703-989-6819. Smoky Mountain Wrestling and your civic group, an unbeatable tag team.
Let's hear these words about the tag team situation from the Heavenly Bodies and the Fantastics.
All right, guys, I got to ask you one question. I've taken the step of doing something I haven't done in a long time. I've called home. I've asked Mama for cash. She's putting up $10,000 that says we can take the Fantastics. Now, I'm asking you, can I put my faith in you that her $10,000 is going to be safe?
Jimmy, we'd kick their cans for free, but the fact that your dear, sweet mother put that money up is even more incentive for us to kick their butts, right, Tom?
They don't have nothing to worry about, Jimmy. We're not only going to take your mom's money and not do nothing with it, we want our belts back.
Okay, you cowards, that's the story. $10,000 on the line, brother. We're putting it up. Give us a title match.
Jim Cornette and Heavenly Bodies, you talk about a rematch. Well, I tell you what. Not too long ago, you injured my knee. You put the Fantastics out for a while, and you made us wait. Now we're going to make you wait.
That's right, Cornette. We said it. You offered $10,000. Well, let me tell you something. I understand that your mama made a long-distance call down to you. She said she'd be willing to work the streets of Louisville, Kentucky, just to get those tag team belts around your men. Well, let me tell you something, Cornette. This is from the Fantastics to the Heavenly Bodies, and especially you, Jim Cornette. No dice. Not for $10,000. Hey, Jackie, they're pretty desperate. Maybe they'll offer more.
Wrestling fans, this is a tag team contest introducing first at a combined weight of 448 pounds from Washington, D.C. Here is Tommy Angel. His tag team partner is from right here in the USA, Nitro Danny Davis.
And of course, their opponents, and they're none tougher, and they're none meaner, always led into the ring by Jim Cornette. Here are the Heavenly Bodies.
All right, you rednecks, listen up. As I introduce to you the tag team that's so sexy, they gotta wear brown paper wrappers in Boston. Ladies and gentlemen, the Gangster of Love and the Doctor of Desire, Stan Lee, Tom Pritchard, the Heavenly Bodies.
Well, you're right there. Into the ring, you see Stan Lane.
Cut the music! Cut the music! Stan Lane's eardrum is still busted and injured, so you've got to keep the noise down, please. I said keep the...
Dutch, how long should that eardrum be that way? Is he using this as a crutch or something?
Well, you see, Bob,
that should be healed by now.
His eardrum is a recurring injury from those low-bred, egg-sucking dogs, Fantastics. And let me say one thing. Brian Lee has someone out looking for him. $10,000
yeah.
On Brian Lee's head.
Yeah.
You know
yeah.
Who it is?
No.
I have a good idea who it is.
Who?
I think it's the Fantastics.
No.
Why
they're, not? They're not that kind of people.
Oh, you just
Jackie
don't know
Bobby, Jackie and Bobby are not that way. Good, clean-cut boys. The type of guys that you'd like your sister to go out with.
Who?
The Fantastics.
If the Fantastics set up on my front porch and want to go out with my sister, I'd meet him with a shotgun and walk him right off my property. Hopefully out of earshot, so I might pop him one in the leg or something.
I think Stan Lane is using that headgear as some kind of a weapon. He's got it on there for a purpose.
No. Absolutely not.
Well, you know, Jim Cornette put up $10,000 for a title match. The Fantastics turned it down. Would Cornette be behind?
If somebody
could
needs
he
to
be behind that price of that $10,000 on the head of Brian Lee?
Who?
Jim Cornette.
Of course not. Don't
Well, he certainly could. Why would he not be?
Hey, if there's a price going to be put on somebody's head, it needs to be put on the Fantastics' head. If there's some kind of price or some kind of sale going on. But if they put a price on their head, it'd be like a clearance sale. Hey, great move. Wait a minute. I said I was going to rate a move today, Olympic move, right there. Let's see. Let's put the camera on this. I'm rating this move right here. Almost 9.8.
Oh, come
9.8.
On. No way,
a great
Doug.
Move. Yes,
there was a neck breaker and a good one, but nowhere near something like that.
You see, Bob,
maybe
I,
a 6.5
I am the, no,
or
I am the
you know?
Expert here. I should have judged the Olympics.
Oh, my heavens. Here's Dr. Tom Pritchard leaping right over, and that's right, Danny Davis.
Yes, sir. Well, actually, I was a judge in the Olympics. I just want to keep that quiet. I don't want to tell everybody what I'm doing, because then they'll know and they'll go tell everybody.
Dutch, I think it's just, it's despicable. It's beyond words to think that somebody would put a price on someone's head to bring his career to an end. That's just an unspeakable, horrible situation. I hate to think that somebody connected with Smoky Mountain Wrestling.
How do you know they're connected with
that
Smoky?
Low, that's lower than a snake crawling on his belly.
Let me tell
to
you
do something like that.
Will you let me say something? Who says if somebody in Smoky Mountain Wrestling put the price on him? It may have been an ex-girlfriend. You know, the boy's morals are in question anyway.
Not likely, though. Not likely. It's somebody I'm certain in Smoky Mountain.
Now, look at this
And I don't go right at the moment past Jim Cornette.
Look at this team right here. Great teamwork. Great teamwork. Jimmy Cornette has this team primed and ready to go. They are really doing a number on Nitro Danny Davis right now.
Here's Davis in and off ropes right to the clothesline. Boy, he went down quick from that clothesline. Stan Lane.
He went down like a ton of bricks.
Now Lane again puts his hand over that ear like he's still being affected by the noise from the crowd. Good move right there by Danny Davis. Quickly in comes Tom Pritchard.
Good move.
Grabbed him by the hair, just rolled him a flip backward.
That's good tag team wrestling right there. The alertness. You see, all great wrestlers have two things in common. Stamina and endurance and balance. And all these men are great athletes, but I think the Heavenly Bodies are a great, great team in their own right, and I don't think the Fantastic will hold on to those belts very long.
Look at Tommy Angel just scooped up first Pritchard, and then he went right to Stan Lane. Scooped them both up for the slam. That was a double team. Lane from behind, and the clothesline by Pritchard. Here's the double team on him again. Out of the air with a backflip and a little assist from Lane. He's got him covered, and the leg is hooked. Could this be it? It is.
Your winners of the match, Tom Pritchard and Stan Lane, the Heavenly Bodies.
Well, there we see them, Bob. The Heavenly Bodies managed by Jim Cornette on the comeback trail. Hot on the Fantastic. The Fantastics and Bob Armstrong, no doubt, stole the belts from the Heavenly Bodies at Fire on the Mountain in Johnson City. Let's take a look at this. Let's look at some great tag team in action right here. We see Stan Lane and the doctor right there, Tom Pritchard, shooting Tommy Angel in. Pritchard going deep, and Stan Lane giving a little bit of help. A great win for the Comeback Kids, managed by Jim Cornette. Fans, don't go away. The Rock and Roll coming up soon.
Wrestling fans in Beckley, get ready, because Smoky Mountain Wrestling is heading your way to the Raleigh County Armory on Sunday, September the 6th, at a special time, noted 7 p.m. The Bratton Twins will be on this big wrestling card. Also, a return match. Two referees, Paul Orndorff and Ronnie Garvin. A six-man grudge tag match. The Heavenly Bodies and Killer Kyle take on Brian Lee, Tim Horner, and Dixie Dynamite. In a stretcher match, one man must be carried out. It'll be the Rock and Roll Express taking on Robert Fuller and Jimmy Gold in the Stud Stable.
You know, Phil, Rick, and I'd like to thank all the fans out there, the ones that's been with us from the beginning and the ones that are here now, especially the ones that hold up the signs that say Rock and Roll Express is back on track. Let me tell you something, Jimmy Gold and Robert Fuller. This time it's a stretcher match, boy. You better be ready to come for a fight.
You know, Robert, I can say to you and I can say to all the nice fans, I know I made a lot of mistakes in my life. But one mistake that the Stud Stable has made is to jump the Rock and Roll Express. You see, we had you in several different matches, and we won every one of them. But when the match was over, brother, you had to jump us from behind. But you see, this time right here in Beckley, West Virginia, it's going to be just a little bit different. You see, the match is not over until somebody's carried out in a stretcher. I mean, feet first, brother, and it's not going to stop right there. We don't care what it takes, Stud Stable, we're going to do away from you, because we've been down many, many highways, and every road we took led us to the top. And all those nice fans out there in Beckley, West Virginia, know that. They know that the Rock and Roll Express is here to stay. We're not here to play. Robert Fuller, Jimmy Golden, baby, you bring all you got. Come on down there, be big and bad. But remember one thing, you can always be had by the hands of the Rock and Roll Express. We've been there before, and we're going there again. And we'd like to say one more thing. I'd like to thank all the nice fans out there in Beckley, West Virginia, that stood behind us through thick and thin. But brother, Rock and Roll Express is going to be there again. We'll see you, Jimmy Golden, Robert Fuller, right here in Beckley, West Virginia.
Don't forget, wrestling fans, the date, September the 6th. You'll want to be at the Raleigh County Armory for this big wrestling match. And also, the big card, it's getting bigger all the time. So you'll want to be in Beckley, the Raleigh County Armory.
Get
bell
up,
time,
boys.
8 o'clock. You'll want to be there, wrestling fans.
All right, fans, we'll be right now. Paul Lee, the Nature Boy, Buddy Landell. Buddy.
You know, I'd just like to say something. This Paul Lee right here, I've been noticing this guy's very talented, very underrated. I'm going to take you under my wing. Paul Lee, who is the greatest wrestler of all time?
The Nature Boy.
And who is the Nature Boy?
You, Buddy Landell.
You know, Paul, I can see a lot of potential in you. You know what? I'm going to use you. I mean, I'm going to put your talent to use. We're getting ready to kick the Rock and Roll Express. How does that sound?
Great. Thank you.
I tell you, if they're going to kick it, I got to see it, and you fans will too. So right now, let's go to the ring.
What did he say?
Wrestling fans introducing at a combined weight of 450 pounds, from Chattanooga, Tennessee, Paul Lee, and from Jacksonville, Florida, the Nature Boy, Buddy Landell.
Well, it's no secret that Buddy Landell is the real Nature Boy in professional wrestling, but what did Buddy Landell say about Paul Lee?
Well, he said, I'm going to use you. I mean, use you up there. Hey, listen to this crowd. Watch this introduction. Watch them come in. The crowd is just going to explode. Here they are, fans. Four times, but the World Tag Team Champions, Rock and Roll, is certainly here to stay. The Rock and Roll Express.
Well, fans, here's their long-awaited reunion right here in Smoky Mountain Wrestling. After a separation of more than 2 years, the Rock and Roll have reunited.
Wrestling fans at a combined weight of 446 pounds from Memphis, Tennessee, Ricky Martin and Robert Gibson, the Rock and Roll Express.
Ricky and Robert, fans, the Rock and Roll Express. And you know, Dutch, it's great to see one of the best tag teams of all time back together again. But you know, they didn't have the easiest time in their debut, and they had a whale of a team to go against in their debut, and that's the Stud Stable.
Well, when they went against the Stud Stable, they didn't go against an easy team. See, Robert Fuller, Jimmy Golden are cousins. They've been together for a long time.
They're big.
They're very, very close friends of mine. But when they stepped in, they're not like any other team.
Now, wait a minute.
You see Fuller and Golden fight back.
You mean that's the kind of people you associate with when you say that they're very close friends of yours?
They are very close friends of mine. And talking about close friends, Robert Fuller has joined us.
Wait a minute. I'll give him my microphone. Hold on a minute.
Okay,
I'll give it to him. You just step
right out. Fans, let me tell you right now, Robert Fuller and Jimmy Golden have joined me at the table right here, at the announcing table. And I'm sure, Robert, glad to have you out here.
Well, thank you very much, Dutch. You know, I saw these boys creating the stirs they normally do, coming out here trying to stir these boys up with rock and roll. I know more about rock and roll than they'll ever figure out. You know, I came out here, I just had to tell you, you're not going to be on this program long because the Olympic Committee is going to be calling you because the way you score this thing is beautiful, Dutch.
Thank you very much. Now, Robert, I want to ask you and Jimmy, how long, see, at the, your first meeting at Fire on the Mountain, you left these boys laying right in the middle of the ring.
What are your
future plans for the rock and roll?
Well, the future plans for them to see them out of here. You know, I don't think the people care for the rock and roll. They talk about the reunion, the great reunion taking place. There's a great reunion taking place, and everybody knows about it. It's the Stud Stable reunion. It's Jimmy Golden and Robert Fuller taking over. You grade this right here, Dutch, you're not going to be able to say one time these boys did any better than a two all night long, I guarantee you that.
Okay, Robert, I'll tell you, I'm going to rate this right here. I'm going to let you hold this up. Do you agree with that figure?
I think it's a little high, but okay. What the heck?
Okay, if we can put the camera on this is Robert Fuller's rating of the rock and roll. I'll let you be an Olympic judge right here. Can you see it? 2.7 for the rock and roll. And obviously,
that's good, Dutch. It's a little high for him, but still, that's good.
Okay, now, they are four times United States World Tag Team Champion. Does that impress you and Jimmy?
You know something, that don't impress me at all. You know what? It's not the has-been I'm worried about. It's what you can do today. Like I said before, if you're going to have a big ruckus about a reunion, then let's talk about the greatest thing to ever happen to these old Smoky Mountains over here, and that's the Stud Stable of Jimmy Golden and the Tennessee Stud. You see the double teaming taking place in here now. You can take some off your pointage there because double teaming is not going to get it. And that's all these boys do all night long is double team.
Well, see, that's obviously, you see, they work that way. They cheat. And see, everybody thinks of rock and roll. They don't cheat, but they cheat everybody every move they make, correct?
Yeah, absolutely. If you're in the ring with them, right away you're going to figure it out, because here they come, two at a time all the time. You know, I like to get in the ring heads up. Jimmy does too. Take his man on heads up. What do we got to do? Fighting two of them continuously. I've never been double teamed so much in all my life, and I've had it, Dutch. I'm going to tell you, I've had it with these boys.
Well, see, I think we're talking about the Rock and Roll four-time world tag team champion. You see, not a lot is said about the Stud Stable, the Continental title, the Southern title, and all the other titles you've held.
Look at that double team. I'm out of here. It's just sickening me, Dutchman.
Okay, Robert, thanks for coming.
From the Rock and Roll Express.
Well, there you heard it, fans. Robert Fuller giving his unbiased opinion of the Rock and Roll Express, but they do take the measure of Buddy Landell and Paul Lee here in their debut here in Smoky Mountain Wrestling. If we can get a little run back, there we see Buddy Landell telling Paul Lee what he should have done and everything else. Right now, fans, let's take a, if we can take a look at it here, what happened? We see Ricky and Robert with their signature move, the double drop kick. It may work on Paul Lee, Bob Caudle, but I do not think in my wildest dreams that it would work on a team like the Stud Stable. Fans, stay tuned. We'll be right back with Down and Dirty with Dutch, my special guest, the Dirty White Boy, and Ron Wright. Don't go away.
Now you can see the excitement of the Volunteer Slam in your own home. A one-night tournament to crown the first-ever Smoky Mountain champion is available on video cassette. The eight top stars of Smoky Mountain Wrestling are featured in seven great matches to decide who the best really is. To order your Volunteer Slam tape, send $15 plus $2 postage and handling to Smoky Mountain Wrestling, Post Office Box 1279, Morristown, Tennessee, zip code 37815, or write for a free merchandising catalog.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to Down and Dirty with Dutch. I'm Dutch Mantell, and you're not. But right now, my special guest, ladies and gentlemen, let's give a big North Carolina welcome to the Dirty White Boy, the new reigning Smoky Mountain heavyweight champion. And White Boy, I want to congratulate you. I want to be one of the first to congratulate you on your outstanding win. Can I just touch that belt? Woo! You're hot, baby. You're hot. And Ron Wright, you've got your dream come true, and I would just like you to tell the fans at home your comments right now.
Well, I tell you, it's been a rough life. I had to get up out of my hospital bed to come over here to make sure they didn't rob that man that belt. And I say one thing, Dirty White Boy, he's coming around. He's got me off of that old cheap generic heart medicine and got me on the real stuff. My heart's getting a little stronger. And we're getting money in the bank now to have this hip implant surgery. And it won't be no time till this Dirty White Boy. And I'll tell you, especially since we've got this big heavyweight championship belt here, you know, this thing brings us in a lot of money. I'll have that hip surgery and I'll be back on my feet and probably be up there able to kick somebody's head off when they go to mess with my man up there. I'm just tickled to death and so happy I can't hardly stand it. But I still have to carry my heart monitor this in case.
Yeah,
you know, I do a lot of praying to the good Lord not to let me have no more of these spells.
Right.
But, you know, I can't control that, but I hope we're getting them under control.
All right. Now, White Boy, let me ask you right now. A lot of people saying a lot of bad things about you. What do you think the future holds for the Dirty White Boy?
The future holds for the Dirty White Boy nothing but greatness. That's all that is coming my way, and that's all that's coming Mr. Wright's way. Now, Ron, I made you a promise that I would get this title, and I've got it. Now we're going to have all your operations. They can cut you from stem to stern, and before you know it, you're going to be out of that chair. And another thing, I'm not going to be like the former champion, Prime Time Brian Lee. I'm going to be a fighting champion. The kind of champion that will go against such people as Ronnie Garvin, Paul Orndorff, the Rock and Roll Express, the Heavenly Bodies, the Fantastics. It doesn't make one bit of difference who you stick in that ring against me, because the bottom line is, when I walk out, I will still walk out the Smoky Mountain heavyweight champion. And Dutch, I'd just like to say one thing. It's been a pleasure and an honor being out here with you on your program.
Thank you very much. But let me ask you one question before you go. What is your reflection on giving Tim Horner a championship match? He's been bumping his gums. What do you think about Tim Horner?
Well, Tim Horner, I hate to tell you, son, but you're not in the top category that it takes to get a shot at this title. So I don't see you getting a shot no time in the future. I'm sorry, son. You hadn't proved nothing to me.
All right, there you had it, fans. The Dirty White Boy and Ron Wright giving their unbiased opinions on the heavyweight championship scene right here in Smoky Mountain. Fans, don't go away. We'll be back in 2 minutes.
If you'd like to raise money for your school, club, or civic organization, and you'd like to see the excitement of Smoky Mountain Wrestling live in your hometown, this message is for you. High school and college athletic departments, sports teams, police and fire departments, JCs, civic groups, or any group wishing to raise money can bring the stars of Smoky Mountain Wrestling to town for a night of action and receive a portion of the receipt. Write to us or call Sandy Scott at 703-989-6819. Smoky Mountain Wrestling and your civic group, an unbeatable tag team.
Wrestling fans, introducing from Raleigh, North Carolina, 228 pounds, here is Robbie Eagle.
All right, fans, and making his way now toward the ring, the former Smoky Mountain heavyweight champion, and I think destined to regain that title. What a great competitor and outstanding wrestler he is. Here comes prime time, Brian Lee.
Well, one of your words describing Brian Lee was very appropriate, and that is former. He is the former champion, not the present champion.
His opponent is from Orlando, Florida, 280 pounds, prime time, Brian Lee.
6'8", 280 pounds, and Dutch, I don't think it's long that title is going to be around the waist of the Dirty White Boy. I think this man right here is going to regain that championship and do it very quickly. By the way, let me say this. You and Robert Fuller, you two guys must belong to some mutual admiration society. The sugar was just dripping from your mouths over here as you guys tried to compliment each other. Dutch, I never thought you were that type of an individual.
Well, I see you out here talking to Tim Horner and you talking to Brian Lee and you're sucking up to them. I see you doing that, Bob. But Robert Fuller is a friend of mine, and I make no bones about it. Jimmy Golden, too, and a Dirty White Boy. Those are my friends.
Yeah, I think that's got to say something about the company you keep when you talk about friends like that. I cannot imagine that you, without in public and on television, want to claim those guys as friends. Good move right there by Brian Lee. He just caught Robbie Eagle right into the air, turned him right around with that belly-to-belly, slammed him hard to the mat. Here's the man that's coming back strong. After the new Smoky Mountain champion, the Dirty White Boy. You know, the other thing about it, he's got a price on his head now, Dutch, and that he's got to watch every step.
Well, let me say this. He was a marked man ever since the Volunteer Slam. Marked man, and I knew it wouldn't be long before somebody actually got the best of Brian Lee. See, when you got guys after you like White Boy and you got guys after you like Paul Orndorff, something's got to give before long. He's making a very good showing here because right now, Brian Lee, he has some incentive to come back. He wants the Dirty White Boy, and I'm sure the White Boy would like nothing better than to put Brian Lee right out of the wrestling scene right here in Smoky Mountain Wrestling.
Well, you heard right, say, and the Dirty White Boy.
Your winner of the match, prime time, Brian Lee.
I think the White Boy's got to be wondering, what the heck is this? Hey, there's it. Whatever it is again, coming after Brian Lee.
There's that guy again.
Where in the heck did the guy come from? He's not in the dressing room. He's not a wrestler. He wasn't in the audience. The guy came from outside somewhere. Look at him. Just really going to work now in prime time, Brian Lee.
Who is that guy?
I think the Dirty White Boy has got to be worried. I don't know whether he's behind this, Jim Cornette's behind it, Ron Wright. And out of the ring he goes, and the guy's leaving. We're going to take a break, fans. We'll be back.
Who is that guy?
Now you can see the excitement of the Volunteer Slam in your own home. A one-night tournament to crown the first-ever Smoky Mountain champion is available on video cassette. The eight top stars of Smoky Mountain Wrestling are featured in seven great matches to decide who the best really is. To order your Volunteer Slam tape, send $15 plus $2 postage and handling to Smoky Mountain Wrestling, Post Office Box 1279, Morristown, Tennessee, zip code 37815, or write for a free merchandising catalog.
Wrestling fans, introducing from Atlanta, Georgia, 250 pounds, Mr. Wonderful, Paul Orndorff. His opponent tonight is from Atlanta, Georgia, 235 pounds, Hands of Stone, Ronnie Garvin.
All right, and what a main event this is, Dutch.
This is a tremendous main event, and very seldom do you see a main event of this caliber on television. Now, you may see it on a pay-per-view. You may have to go buy a ticket to see it, but here's Smoky Mountain Wrestling. Right. And I will give credit. I will give credit to Bob Armstrong. He's a complete idiot, an imbecile, of course, but he does have the foresight to know what the fans want to see. Ronnie Garvin, the Hands of Stone, against Mr. Wonderful, Paul Orndorff, both men. Their signature move all through the years has been the pile driver, and the question remains, even though the pile driver is banned in Smoky Mountain Wrestling, the question remains, who is the true master of the pile driver? Good shoulder block by Garvin. Pulls it back into that headlock. He's trying to control Orndorff by controlling the head. And I've said this many, many times, and I'm sure a lot of wrestling fans have always heard it. When you control the head, you control the body. Now, what wrestling is, ladies and gentlemen, it is a game of mental chess. So when you take a wrestler, when they just look ahead one move, they're going to lose the match. They got to look ahead three or four moves, and some wrestlers will even do a move or two just to feel their opponent out, and then whammo, they got them. They've trapped them. They've lulled them to sleep, so to speak.
Well, you're right, Dutch. The great ones all do that. They think far ahead, sort of like a chess master. They know what they're going to do several moves down, and they also know what they're going to do and how they're going to counter a certain move by an opponent.
Whoa, good.
There's Orndorff, had a couple of good right hands right on the button as you saw Garvin backed into the corner, and boy, I tell you, you got him right on the jaw and high onto the ear on one of them. But I think Orndorff right now, he may be sealing his own doom. I don't think you want to trade blows with the Hands of Stone. Garvin, he can turn your lights out with one blow.
Well, sometimes the reputation is deserved and sometimes it's not. In Ronnie Garvin's case, he has deserved that reputation as Hands of Stone. But right now, he needs to get up and make and utilize to the best of his abilities his talent. He needs to get off that mat. Well, you can't let a man of the caliber of Mr. Wonderful, Paul Orndorff, get you down and start hammering on you.
Well, and that's what Orndorff has done. He was kicking and stomping away at Garvin. Backs away now, measures him for the big elbow. And he got that fist right down. Where'd that? Right down across the throat, Dutch. Boy, he's going to cut all of his hair off with that. That was right down across his windpipe. And Garvin is very slow to get to his feet, using the ropes for a little extra leverage there to try to, and a little assist. And Orndorff, he went right back to that float again with those fingers.
Well, he knows he's got Garvin sort of on the ropes. As you can see, Garvin is very weak at this point. See, a lot of people underestimate Mr. Wonderful's power. A very powerful man. Played football for the New Orleans Saints at one time. A great athlete. Of course, I'm not taking anything away from the Hands of Stone, Ronnie Garvin. Both of them are great athletes and have win against the best.
Let me ask you this. He's really mauling Garvin. You think if he gets him in a position that he may try to pull the pile driver on him, that he may try to end it with Garvin right there, try to prove to him who's the master of the pile driver?
Well, it's no big secret. Paul Orndorff, he's got a lot of money. He's a wealthy man. So the last time he did this, he was fined $2,500. But you see, now you see what the referee did there? He blocked the shot, and that gave Ronnie Garvin the momentum.
Turnbuckle, time and time again now. Orndorff having his head slammed hard to the turnbuckle by Garvin, who had him by the hair at the back of the head. That was a big chop right down across the chest.
He's going for the pin.
Oh, only two.
A lot of power in that kick out, too. A lot of power by Orndorff. You see a lot of guys just barely kick out, but he kicked out with power. He kicked out with force and confidence.
And a collision. As Orndorff went into the ropes in the collision, and they both go down. And the referee now, after the center of the ring, starts to count over both of them.
Now, sometimes when two men collide, their heads either hit or both their wind gets knocked out of them at the same time.
Well, it was Garvin on the head. You saw Garvin holding his head as he was trying to get to his feet. Now Garvin first on his feet to look at him stagger and reel around the ring. Goes right back now to the attack.
Well, this is the main event we talked about.
He made pile driving. He's trying to get into the
position. That is illegal. That is illegal.
Is he going to do it?
Wait a minute. That's illegal.
Orndorff had him blocked.
Wait a minute.
With a back toss.
No.
The right hand now with the knees dropped right down across
the back.
Wait
a minute. He's got him cradled back.
He's got him pinned. Only a count of two again. Oh, Dutch, we've been so close. Each one of them has been right there to being pinned.
These men have went against the very best in professional wrestling and have beaten beaten every one of them at least a couple of times. Yes, we're talking about the Hulk Hogan's. We're talking about the Ric Flair's. We're talking about the Ricky Steamboat's. We're talking about the Tito Santana's. And we're talking about everybody who's anybody in professional wrestling. Their one loss record collectively and together looks like a who's who of professional wrestling.
Orndorff trying to pull him out of the corner. Garvin now holding on to the rope. Orndorff trying to get him up for the pile driver. Garvin knows what was coming.
Come on, Paul, lay it on him. Pop him.
Now he's got him in a position. Watch out. Can Garvin block this one?
Well, they may be going for it.
Looks like Orndorff may be going for the pile driver. Garvin trying to block it, and he does. And the rope.
Right into the corner. Right into the top turnbuckle.
Now looks like that took a lot out of Garvin again. He's staggering around the ring. There's that big, hard right hand. There's a headbutt. Down goes Orndorff from the head. And another headbutt. Look at his legs. How wobbly he is.
Now tell me that move is not despicable. Sleeper.
He's got him in a sleeper. He may put him out right here with a sleeper.
Well, he certainly has the advantage on Mr. Wonderful right now.
Is Orndorff going to go out?
I don't think so. Orndorff has got too much reserve energy, too much reserve strength. I talked to Paul right before we went on the air today, and he said he's in the finest shape of his life, and he was looking forward to kicking Ronnie Garvin's brains out, which I told him. I said, you don't have to do much kicking because Ronnie Garvin doesn't have a lot of brains to start off with.
Garvin had him covered. He was ready for the count of three, and Orndorff got a foot across the rope, and again he got it across. Now he can't. Oh, but that time he couldn't hold him.
Well, he's got him cinched in there just a little bit. He may get a pin on Paul Orndorff. No. You see
that? He got his shoulder up there close to the ropes. He can't keep his feet off of the ropes and keep his shoulders down at the same time.
Do you see the strength of Orndorff coming up? He's coming up.
Well, they've both taken a tremendous pounding, Dutch, and it's got to be telling on him at this stage of the match. Yeah, looks like Garvin trying to get him in a position where he's going to roll him over, stack him up. He's got him stacked. Oh, and almost three. The hand had started down from the referee when Orndorff was managed to roll right on through. Another headbutt, and it's got him wobbly on his feet again. Again now, Orndorff reeling, goes to the eyes.
Well, both men are dazed right now. Garvin with a thumb in the eye. And, of course, Orndorff on those headbutts from Garvin.
He ducked under it. There's Garvin with the right hand. That may be it. That could very well be it. The lights may be out on Orndorff. He's out, Dutch. Garvin just standing over him.
Now, you see, he is asking these stupid fans, do they want the
pile
driver?
He should have gone ahead and pinned him.
They shouldn't ask these fans. They will agree to anything.
He's trying to roll him over. It may be a mistake on the part of Garvin. It could turn out to be a fatal mistake.
Now, this is illegal. Where is Bob Armstrong?
The referee is saying no. Is Orndorff going to be piled right or not? He's up. And the referee put him back down.
Good move.
Now the referee.
Good move. Good move with
the
referee.
And Garvin are having a set, too. All of this time, Orndorff has been out. He could have counted to 50 on him.
But I don't think he just wants to pin Paul Orndorff. I'm sure there's a Garvin stomp.
The stomp by Garvin all the way around the body, up and down the legs, all around the body, across the midsection, under the chest and under the arms and on the head.
In other words, he went around the world on him.
He's got him covered, too.
Still can't get him.
Only a two again. What a whale of a match, fans. And as Dutch said, only right here on Smoky Mountain Wrestling do you see this kind of action. And Dutch, we'll have more of it next week when the Rock and Roll Express meet Robert Fulton and Jimmy Golden right here.
There's a headbutt. Headbutt, a good heads-up move by Paul Orndorff. You see, they don't call him Mr. Wonderful for nothing. He earned that name. He knows exactly where he is and exactly what he's doing. Even though he was dazed just a few moments ago, a lot of reserve energy and a lot of reserve power.
And now it's Garvin in trouble on his back, trying to get to his feet with his legs crossed.
These men both.
He's trying to get every reserve bit of strength and power that he's got left. And here's Orndorff with a knee right to the side of the head. And now Orndorff down. They've taken such a tremendous pounding, Dutch. They're both out on their feet.
Well, if one man wins, we'd have to say that it might be a matter of attrition.
Just a tremendous match all the way. And it's only due to the fact that these men are in such outstanding condition and great shape that they're able to do this. What a backbreaker from Orndorff.
And he's still got him stretched out there. That is a very, very painful move. Kids, don't try this at home on your brother or your sister or your mama. Might reach up and slap you in the back of the head and send you in the
bedroom. Now here's Orndorff. Got him covered for a pin. And this time it's Garvin with a foot on the rope.
That's a chicken way to do it.
Hey, what do you mean? Orndorff did it two or three times earlier.
Well, that's because Garvin had him all the way in the rope. He couldn't help himself.
No way, Dutch. What's good for one, of course, is good for the other. Look, Orndorff right to the choke.
He's got his
hand right around his throat, just choking him under the rope. Garvin reached up, tried to get a choke hold on Orndorff, but couldn't hold it.
Now the camera's real.
The animosity and the hatred. You can see the darts just flying between these two when they look each other in the eyes.
Yeah, there's a lot of dislike and a lot of animosity between them.
And Garvin, he was sort of resting his head over in the corner on that turnbuckle.
Garvin's trying to regroup. He's trying to get that second win. And he really needs it right now. If he's going to think he can win this match, he's going to have to come back pretty soon, because no man can take a pounding like this from Mr. Wonderful very long and survive.
Two of the best in the world, fans, going at it right here at Smoky Mountain Wrestling. They have certainly lived up to their reputation in this match, though.
Yeah, well, we hyped this match, said it'd be a great match, and it's lived up to everything we said it would be. A big driving knee you just saw by Mr. Wonderful up on the top rope now and ready to come off on the hands of stone right now. Can he get him? Yes!
Got him to the back of the neck, off of the ropes, off of the top rope, and Garvin didn't see it coming.
See, Garvin doesn't know where Orndorff is.
Now here's Orndorff talking about the pile driver.
Bob, I was talking. Can I talk now?
Yeah, Dutch, let me just say this. He may be doing the same thing Garvin did.
He may be
making a fatal mistake by not pinning him.
Well, you know, Bob, that may be the most sensible thing you've said in about 3 months. Wait a minute. The referee pushed him down.
Well, he did it when Garvin had Orndorff up. Orndorff had him up again. Now Orndorff and the referee.
Whoa!
There's the referee. Oh, he cut him a complete flip. Look at Garvin. He's got Orndorff from behind.
Wait a minute.
One. No, wait a minute.
Referee's ringing the bell.
What the heck?
No, why?
A disqualification.
There's a stone running Garvin.
That was a great match. Why was it ruined by the referee? He's dealing with fire when he tries to tell Paul Orndorff what to do.
Orndorff with a metal chair after the referee now. He shoved the referee, cut him a flip. You don't do that. All right, fans, we'll be back right now. Let's hear this.
Get ready in Beckley, West Virginia. Smoky Mountain Wrestling coming your way at the Raleigh County Armory on Sunday, September the 6th. A special time will ring the bell at 7 p.m. The Bratton Twins will also be on this big wrestling card. Also, a return match. Two referees as Paul Orndorff meets the hands of Stone Ronnie Garvin. A six-man grudge tag match. The Heavenly Bodies, Killer Kyle, meet Primetime Brian Lee, Tim Horner, and Dixie Dynamite.
You know, it seems like the last time there in Beckley, my man Killer Kyle about half beat Dixie Dynamite to death. So what happens but Brian Lee sticks his nose in? Brian Lee's got enough problems with $10,000 out on his head. Now Tim Horner's a friend of his. They're getting the whole gang together. So I said, fine. Six-man tag. The Heavenly Bodies and my man, the Killer, going up against Brian Lee, Tim Horner, and Dixie Dynamite. We're going to settle a lot of things right there at the same time. And one is Brian Lee, $10,000 if we put you out of commission. I can't think of anything better I'd like to do than make 10 grand for coming to Beckley. That's about what it's worth.
Also, the main event, we have a stretcher match. One man must be carried out. The Rock and Roll Express, Ricky Morton, Robert Gibson take on the Stud Stable. Robert Fuller, the Tennessee Stud, and Jimmy Golden.
You know, I want to ask you one thing, Mr. Rainey. This so-called hot stuff team called the Rock and Roll Express is supposed to have all these big-time wins all around the country. Since they've been to Smoky Mountain Wrestling, they haven't won one match against me and the Tennessee Stud right here, brother. They've gone down every night. Now we're coming to a match where they want to challenge us to get into the ring, to where we beat each other down till nobody can get up. They put you on a stretcher, carry you out to the ambulance, and carry you off to the hospital. I'm going to tell you something right now, boys. This is your last day in Beckley, West Virginia. You come on down, we're going to show you the real men.
I'll tell you what I think about it, Jimmy. I think it's darn right excellent. I think it's the greatest thing that ever happened, because when I go to Beckley, West Virginia, get off the jet, I'm already feeling terrible, and I'm ready for a fight anyway. You boys want to ride a stretcher out in Beckley? Climb your tail through there with a Tennessee Stud, because you're going to do it.
I know you didn't want to win it that way.
Bob.
You wanted to take him out.
This thing is getting out of hand. Completely. First, I was involved in Smoky Mountain Wrestling because they called me. I was very flattered that they asked the people to write in who they wanted for Brian Lee's partner, who they thought the toughest man was, and letters and letters and letters came in saying Ronnie Garvin. Well, thank you, fans. I was very pleased, very flattered. It's a great honor. But I was almost retired from wrestling, and I came in to help Brian Lee because there was a lot of bad things happening to him, and I thought it was going to be a one-night affair, and that was it. But Paul Orndorff, you've stepped on my toes, you've stepped on my egos, and you've insulted me, and you're bragging too much, and you're insulting the people, and I'm going to pile drive you for life.
Right there from Ronnie Garvin fans next week. What a great main event we have for you next week. The Rock and Roll Express against Robert Fuller and Jimmy Golden right here next week, fans.